Church, aren't you glad he's alive? Do you remember the first time he called your name? I often wondered what it would have been like to be Lazarus when he heard Jesus say, "Lazarus, come forth." But you know what? I can think back, and I don't have to really think too hard, to the moment when I began to hear Jesus speak to me. When I was in every bit as much of darkness and death as Lazarus, and yet he called my name and he opened my eyes, and I began to see the truth of the salvation that I so desperately needed. I began to see and understand the love of God. And what I've found in this journey with Jesus is it's not just once that he calls your name. I praise God because he's called my name over and over. I praise God that when I was 18 years old, I went on my first mission trip. And I heard him call me and I heard him say, without a doubt, "I want you to go and share the gospel." And I went on that trip and it so changed my life. It was to Native Indians in South Dakota. I remember sitting there beside the bed that last night, which really wasn't a bed, it was kind of a pallet on the floor. And I remember getting down on my knees and I remember telling the Lord, "I hear you calling me." I didn't know what that meant, but here's what I told him. "Every year for the rest of my life, if you will give me an opportunity to go to the furthest reaches of this earth, I'll be faithful to go." And you know what's amazing? 18 seems like a long time ago. Every year of my life since I was 18, you know what he's done? He's been faithful to provide a way for me to fulfill the calling that he placed on me. I heard him call me to preach. Scared me to death. I'm not going to lie to you. When he called me to preach, I wasn't in any, I had no concept of being a pastor. I knew he was calling me to ministry. I didn't know what it looked like. And the first thing I said was, "Well, I'm not going to do youth." Guess what the first thing was that I did? And then I said, "I'll never pastor a church." And guess what I'm doing? Do you hear him calling you? There's nothing more glorious than when God calls your name, because let me tell you what he's doing. He's raising up leaders all around this world who will be faithful with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you say, "Well, you know what? He's not going to use me because I'm a nobody." No, that is actually the person that he wants to use. The one who says, "I can't." The one actually who, in their own feeble mind, say, "I won't." It's almost like God smiles and says, "I bet you will." And he calls us. The story of Nehemiah is an amazing story because here is this unknown who is serving at the right hand of a pagan king. Little could he have ever imagined that he would be a champion of the faith who would be remembered alongside the names of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Joshua, Joseph, David, Isaiah, Jeremiah. Could you have ever, do you think for a moment on that day that he ever could have imagined what God was calling him to do, what he was raising him up to do, how thousands of years later we would still be speaking of his name because he heard the voice of God call his name and he was faithful to say yes. This is a man that had been experiencing for years exile. All that he's known all of his life has been exile. Yet he was a man of God who believed the word of God, and he prayed for God to move among his people. And as he began to pray for God to move among his people, you know what he realized? I said it a few weeks ago. We are many times the answer to our own prayer. And in the midst of praying, we find this week that not only was he praying, but as it became apparent to him what the problem was and what the answer was, amazingly, he began to think through, what would I do if God called me? And by the time God called his name, in that moment, 4 months after, God laid it on his heart. Remember, we said for 4 months, this man had been praying, this man had been on his knees. Now in chapter 2, we come to the moment when God calls his name specifically and sets him on a path to do his will. You see, not only was he praying for God to move among his people, but we find that he was planning for what he could do so that he would be ready if God were to give him the opportunity. Is that how you live your life? Expectant, waiting for God to call your name and say, son, get in the game. Let's read together chapter 2. Beginning in verse 1, it simply says, and it came about in the month of Nisan, not the car, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, that wine was before him. And I took up the wine and I gave it to the king. Now I had not been sad in his presence. So the king said to me, why is your face sad, though you're not sick? This is nothing but sadness of heart. Then I was very much afraid. I said to the king, let the king live forever. Why should my face not be sad when the city, the place of my father's tombs, lies desolate? Its gates have been consumed by fire. Then the king said to me, what would you request? So I prayed to the God of heaven. I said to the king, if it pleases the king, if your servant has found favor before you, send me to Judah, to the city of my father's tombs, that I may rebuild it. Then the king said to me, the queen sitting beside him, how long will your journey be, and when will you return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I gave him a definite time. And I said to the king, if it pleases the king, let letters be given to me for the governors of the provinces beyond the river, that they may allow me to pass through until I come to Judah. A letter to Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the fortress which is by the temple, for the wall of the city, for the house to which I will go or I will live. And the king granted them to me because, underline this, the good hand of God was on me. Then I came to the governors of the provinces beyond the river and gave them the king's letters. Now the king had sent me with officers of the army and the horsemen, and Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official heard about it, and it was very displeasing to them that someone had come to seek the welfare of the sons of Israel. This morning I want to share with you what is required if we're going to be obedient to God's will. If we're going to be obedient to God's call on our life, what is that going to look like for us? What does it require of us? We know, and we've already talked about the kind of man that God uses out of chapter 1. And when we saw last week how God called this man of God who was burdened, this man of God who was concerned for others, this man of God who was a praying man, we saw that he was a man ready to be used in so many ways. He was a man clinging to hope. Not hope in a king, an earthly king, but a hope in the King of Kings. He believed that God would answer every promise. And now that moment has come. Number one, you have to understand that many times doing God's will, and this doesn't sound right, but it's true, listen to me. Doing God's will requires waiting. You see, just by the very nature of the sentence, the first word we key in on is what? Doing. Do you realize that God is much more interested in you being than doing? The key to fruitfulness in the Christian life, is it not abiding? Did he not say that if you abide in me, I will abide in you, then you will what? Then you will bear much fruit. Most of us live our life backwards spiritually because we are so determined to do for God, to bear fruit for God, that we forget that it begins with intimacy. It begins with loving him. It begins with serving him. It begins with getting before him every day, hearing his voice, and responding back to God in prayer so that he can transform our lives, so we can go out and transform the world through his power. And you see, it's very deceptive because we always begin with doing God's will, and we forget that the first part of doing God's will many times is waiting. That's what the very first sentence says. 4 months ago, he was burdened, wasn't he? For many of us, we might think that it would be appropriate for him to just walk in and say to the king, "King, I'm out." But you know what? He doesn't have that option, does he? Just as God has done over and over for the children of Israel, don't you love it how when they were considering how in the world are they going to survive if they leave Egypt and go into the desert, and yet God's plan all along was he told them even before it happened, listen, don't worry, because everything you need, guess who's going to give it to you? The Egyptians. It's amazing, this pagan king who could care less really about the children of Israel is about to give them everything in God's timing that they need to accomplish what God has called them to do. Never forget this truth. Even in the New Testament, you remember the first thing that Jesus told the disciples to do? Remember how the mission began in the New Testament scriptures when he ascended into heaven and he told them that they would go and preach the gospels to the end of the earth? And you would think, there it is, there is the go, and our instinct is to run right into it. And yet God then turns around and tells them, but first you must what? Wait. Go, but wait. Why? Because they needed the Holy Spirit. That's how the whole mission began. Weeks of waiting. And listen, don't think that waiting does not equate to working. The greatest work that you will do when God says wait is to spend more time where? Praying. Prayer is not wasted time. It is the greatest work, it is the greatest investment that you will make into the kingdom. And if you find yourself in a place where God doesn't seem to be moving, but he is clearly called, you know what he wants, you know what his will is, and you don't know what the next step is to take, then stop trying to take a step and take a knee, right? Because God is going to open the door. He's going to make it abundantly clear what it is that he desires of you. We're in such a hurry. It's just our nature today. In this culture, think about how we live our lives. Do you realize the annual cost of running red lights every year? It's astronomical. When you consider the medical bills, the car repairs, and all the other things that go with people running red lights because they are in such a hurry, it costs us $7 billion a year. Because we don't want to wait 50 seconds, which is the average light cycle. $7 billion, because we can't wait 50 seconds. You see how we live our life? I have watched pastors. I have watched missionaries make the mistake of being unwilling to wait for God. It's one of the hardest things that we do when God calls us. For many missionaries, what God tells them almost immediately is, I mean, there are some that get that have the privilege of being with the IMB. There are many others that are independent missionaries. Do you realize that when you hear the call, many of us just want to get there so fast. We don't think about the fact that, you know what, God wants to do a work in us before we leave. He's showing us where we're going, but it takes a lot of time. And it takes a lot of energy for our hearts to be prepared and for the money to come in, right? Over and over in missions, he says, go, but first wait. I've talked to many pastors, many folks who are going to school to be pastors, and they're so impatient with the education that it takes to get through seminary. And I remind them that, yes, God's goal is for you to be a pastor, but he wants you to be a prepared pastor, and you are not wasting your time by investing in education. But so many people, they bypass the things that God is wanting to do because they don't know how to wait. Patience is a Christian virtue, isn't it? Mel's cousin one time said, her little cousin said, she was little, she said, patience is a Christian virgin. That works too. She meant virtue. It's a virtue. We are like God when we are patient. Isn't it amazing? We serve a God that really, in reality, could just... And yet he's patient. He knows what it is to wait, and he desires of us. It is a fruit of the Spirit. It's something that is meant to be in the life of every believer. I really believe that most of us, we have a faith problem. Because when we truly understand faith, we understand what it is to wait. Because true faith brings a calmness into believers that keeps them from rushing into rash decisions. Let me say that again. True faith brings a calmness into the life of believers that keeps them from rushing into rash decisions. I'm sure Nehemiah is like most of us. He is a doer. Where are the places in your life that you need to learn patience? You say, well, Aaron, I never pray for patience. You don't have to pray for it. Well, if I pray for it, isn't God going to make my life difficult? No. You have misunderstood something. He is going to put things in your life, whether you ask for it or not, so that you can build your faith and become what? Patient. You think by you not praying about it, God's going to let you remain impatient? That's like saying my kids didn't ask me, could they brush your teeth, so I didn't make them. No, don't worry about whether you pray for it. It's something that consider it all joy, brethren, when you go through various what? Trials. Why? Why do you go through various trials? Faith and patience. Because he's going to develop those in you if you are his. Where does your impatience show the most? Is it in stores when you get into a long line? Can I get a what? You know what I'm saying? That's tough. Is it in traffic? Is it with the kids? We just have a problem letting God do things. I mean, we are now a culture that we get angry when the drone doesn't deliver the stuff to our house quick enough. That's where we've gotten. And yet we serve a God that in many ways wants us to wait for his timing. And while we're waiting, we should be growing. We should be thriving. We should be deepening our intimacy with him. And listen, there is nothing wrong. Let me get to that in a minute. I don't want to go there yet. Secondly, doing God's will also requires courage. Because not only has he waited 4 months and let this burden stew and simmer, and he's been praying, but I want you to see that literally it says that he was before Artaxerxes, because Artaxerxes was about to taste wine, and he is the cupbearer, and he has to taste the wine before the king does. So if it's poisoned, he dies and not the king, basically. Great job, isn't it? And he does something this day that is interesting. He looks sad on his face. The reason that's interesting is because when you're in the presence of a king in these days and in these times, go back to the book of Esther, and if you remember, Esther was hesitant to go before the king, not just because she was a woman, not just because he hadn't called her, but it literally says, when you look at the story of Esther, that no one was to go before the king in sackcloth. Now, you go by that because you may not realize what that means. When he says, you cannot come before him in sackcloth, that means that you cannot come before the king in mourning. Why? Because if you're in front of the king, you're supposed to be what? Happy. I mean, number one, this guy is scared to death for his life that people are trying to kill him. So if you come in, you're sweating and you look grumpy, what's he thinking? Number two, you surround him with happiness because the king's supposed to be happy. And if you're in front of a guy that can say, off with his head, you might not want to ruin his good mood, right? Now, what we know of Nehemiah is here is a man of God of great faith. I think the last thing that he is what many of us are in our culture today. We have a lot of Eeyores today. All right, let's get personal. That just wear sadness. Folks, as believers in Jesus Christ, there comes a point where our faith brings about joy. A joy that is regardless of circumstances. And listen, when a heart is burdened, and it's burdened over a lot of time, it eventually will get to the point where it begins to break and sadness will be worn. And that is apparently where he has gotten. He has stood there and he has tried to maintain, he has tried to keep going. But he's gotten to the place where he just, it's just there. Sometimes I wonder, did God let him wait so that he could get to the point that he really was so broken and burdened that he would follow through with everything that was about to come? Because it wasn't going to be easy. And until you solidify a calling that is based on a burden, you most likely will quit. You show me a person that doesn't understand their calling and doesn't have a burden, I'll show you a person that will not last very long in ministry. He wasn't walking around every day grumpy, sad. Woe is me. Oh, bother. He did what so many other people in Scripture did over and over and over, like Joseph. Why was he elevated time and again? Because here was a man of faith and integrity that was blooming where he was planted. He was trusting God with his plan. He was trusting God with his thoughts and his ways. And nobody could deny that there was something strangely different about men like Daniel and men like Joseph and men like Nehemiah. That's how they gained position where they were. Because faith is something that should be so lived out, it's like a star in the night sky. You can't miss it. And that's how he had lived almost every day. The king says, I've never seen you bothered before. But today, there's obviously a sadness. In fact, the king recognizes that. He says it's not a sick sadness, like there's something sickness wrong with you, but he says there seems to be a sadness of what? Of your heart. And the burden of his heart. And see, it's at this moment, I mean, think about this for a second. He says, why is your face sad? There's obviously something wrong going on in your heart. And it says immediately, because we don't think about this with people like Nehemiah. I love that Scripture is so transparent about these men. What does it say? Then I became what? What does it say? Look in your Bible. He said he was afraid. He was afraid, sorely afraid. It means that when the king turned and asked him, and he had good reason to be afraid, because the king could think treachery, the king could think, you know, this isn't my problem, get out of my court. There's a lot of things the king could have done. And his first instinct was what? Fear. Have you noticed that fear is an emotion like any other emotion, that it creeps in and you almost can't control it? I mean, guys tell me all the time, lust creeps in. You're not looking for it. You're not trying to. But listen, we live in a culture where it's hypersexualized, right? The things people wear, the things that are on television, and you have to make yourself turn your head, right? Men, can I get a... Is it just me? Liar. Ted, you're lying in church. The altar will be open in a minute. We all understand. We all get that we all have different sins in our life that really they creep up, or different things that they just, they're just there. But this is a man. See, this is what courage is. We think courage is the absence of fear. That is not courage. Courage is doing what you know is right. Courage for a believer is doing what you know the will of God is, pressing through the fear that you have. Pressing through the excuses that your mind wants to make. And I love it, because in that moment, many of us would have just been so afraid, we would have just walked away. And we'd have said nothing, and we would have put on our smile rather than realizing this is an opportunity. This is God opening a door. How did he know it was a door? Because he was a man of prayer. And I'll tell you, you tend to recognize open doors much better when you're prayerful. You also tend to recognize shut doors when you're prayerful. The reason many of us can't tell the difference is because we're not what? We're not in tune with the Spirit. Fear paralyzes us. Just like we need to see where we're impatient, we also need to see where are the fears in our life that are keeping us from accomplishing the things that God has clearly called us to. For me, for 2 years, I wouldn't tell my mother that I felt a call to ministry. You know why? Because she had paid for a whole lot of school already. In my mind, I thought she has plans for me that I have to carry out. I don't want to disappoint her. But then I'm left with, who do I disappoint? Mommy or God? And for 2 years, I sat there in fear, and I kept going with a degree that I knew wasn't where God was leading me. And I finally went to my mom, and you know what happened? I finally man up, and I walk in there and say, Mom, God has called me to preach the gospel, and I am waiting for everything that in my mind I thought was going to happen. And you know what she said? I knew 2 years ago you were going to do that. I was wondering why you hadn't come and talked to me. I love how he approaches the king. He's courageous, but he's also respectful. He's loyal to the king. Sometimes we have to remember, when we ask for something, those two things go a long way. Courage needs to be balanced with respect. We need both most of the time. But folks, I'm telling you, Luther had it right when he said that faith is a living, daring confidence in the grace of God. It is so certain that a man can stake his life on it 1,000 times. Faith is so certain. The gospel, God's grace, is so certain that a man can stake his life on it 1,000 times. Jesus, I thought, said it very well. You know what he said about faith? All things are possible to him who believes. He said that the smallest amount of faith, you know what it can do? It can move a mountain. Now, Jesus isn't saying, go out to the foothills in North Carolina and say, mountain, get up and move. And it's going to get up and move. Okay? If you noticed, even the televangelists haven't tried that yet, right? It's not what he means. He's saying that all the obstacles that look like mountains before you, they look impassable. You know what he says? If God wants to make a way, guess what he'll do? Then he'll just make a way. So quit being afraid. Do what he's asked you to do, and you see the mountain, but you realize if what he wants from me is over there, God can move the mountain. That's what he means. Courage. Doing God's will requires waiting. Doing God's will requires courage. Thirdly, doing God's will requires dependence. The reason I say dependence, look at what he says. The king, you know, he responds to the king in verse 3, "Let the king live forever. Why should my face not be sad? The city, the place of my father's tombs." Now, I knew the king would respond. He doesn't care so much about Jerusalem, but the king does understand the nature of death and the importance to this man that he loves and cares about for his father's tombs, for the place of his people. He gets what he's asking. He understands the heart of what he's asking. He says it lies desolate. Its gates have been consumed by fire. And then the king says to him, I mean, think about this. He didn't know what to expect. He had the courage to say what was wrong. And then the king looks at him. Remember, I told you last week that God has the ability to turn the heart of a king like he can the waters of a river. And the king looks at him and says, "What do you need?" Who would have thought? What do you need? I love his response. What was his response? He prayed. I don't think he stepped back and said, "Now, King, I don't really know what I need, so let me step back and let me pray." And I don't think he took a 2-hour prayer session while the king waited for his wife to finish the meal as the meal's getting cold. I don't think that all happened. It's kind of like he instant messaged God. You ever walk into a situation where in that moment you need him desperately, but you don't have 4 hours to sit there and pray about it, but you've been praying about it? And right before you walk into a difficult situation, you say, "God, give me the grace and the patience and the wisdom that I need as I walk in here." And that's all that you pray. It's all that you have time to pray. But you know what I love? Is that he is cognizant that if the good hand of the Lord isn't on me, then there ain't nothing going to happen. And he stops, and in that brief moment, what did he say? I don't know. I don't know if he said, "Lord, I'm trusting you." I don't know if he said, "Lord, do what I can't do." I don't know what he said, but I am amazed that he had the wherewithal in the presence of the earthly king to go to the heavenly king and to ask. You know why? Because he was a man that was dependent on God. If you want to accomplish God's will for your life, you must be dependent. Look how reliant this man is on God. His instinct is to always go to God. You pray the way he did in the first chapter. If you pray the way we see that he prayed in the first chapter, this prayer that is based on God's word, God's promise, God's power, God's might, if that is what his prayer life looks like day to day, no wonder in that moment he reached out to God and said, "Do what only you can do." Regular times of prayer must be the context for all of these instant message prayers. I believe that's actually what it flowed out of. This wasn't a Hail Mary because he's been forgetting God this whole time. It wasn't him saying, "God, I have this whole plan and I've yet to come to you about it, but I just want you to bless it." That's not what he was doing. This instant prayer was in the context of prayer that had been going on for months. But it was that moment when God called him to get in the game and he's going, "Okay, God, it's you. I'm going, but it's you." I love the dependence that we see in this man at every aspect and at every moment. This is a man that prays without ceasing. This is a man who prays confidently. This is a man who knows what it is to be intimate with the Lord. This is a man who is seeing effective prayers. Why? Because the prayers of a righteous man, they what? They availeth much. His prayer life, and this is what so many of us don't get, his prayer life poured out into a passion to accomplish God's purpose and what needed to be done. I believe, and let me go ahead and go to the next point, doing God's will requires planning. You see, his prayer life, he knew what he was asking. He knew what the need was. And as he sat there with the need, he may have had no idea what God's role for him was. But he began thinking, if I had an opportunity, these are the things that I know need to happen. And here are how these things could happen. God is not against planning. You do realize that. Now, you need to be sure that your plans are in line with his plans. You better be willing when God says that's not the plan, that you better steer back and get on what is the plan. But I would like to think that every church in the world has thought through, how do we fulfill the Great Commission? How do we do what God has called us to do, to make disciples? If you hadn't thought about it, guess what? You probably ain't doing it. You know why most churches aren't making disciples? Because they haven't even thought about what it looks like to make a disciple. They haven't dug in the Word and they haven't gotten on their knees before God and said, I want to be serious about what it is that you're calling me to do. So if you want to do a great work in our church, has the pastor gotten on his knees and said, how do we accomplish this? Lord, show me what you want me to do. There's nothing wrong with planning. I would say many ministries fail for lack of any planning whatsoever. You say, well, what should we do, pray or plan? Well, who said you only have to choose one thing in life? We're adulting, right? We know how to balance two things at once. Everything in life isn't either or. Sometimes it's both and out of this prayer, out of this walk, out of this intimacy, this burden that he has been thinking about, God, if you open the door, this is what could be done. This is how this could be accomplished. Folks, we need to be cognizant of the fact that Proverbs 16 tells us in verse 9, the heart of a man plans his way, but the Lord establishes his steps. I find it interesting when the king finally asks, what would you request? He prayed. He didn't sit there for 10 minutes and go, well, you know, king, that's a great question. I have no idea. You know what the king would have done? Taste that wine and let's hurry up and get this done and get out of here. Go be sad somewhere else. But notice what he has. When he stands before the king, you know what? He has a plan. He says, we need to go back. And this, again, will remind you why he was a little fearful in his heart. It was King Artaxerxes, this Artaxerxes, that told Ezra. Go back and read Ezra chapter 4. He told Ezra, no one is to go back and rebuild this city. Remember, there was turmoil around the reaching out to rebuild Jerusalem. And Artaxerxes said, nobody will rebuild this city until I say so. That's literally what he said. Now, enter Nehemiah and he says, king. He asked the very thing the king wouldn't let Ezra do. And he found favor with the king. You know what his plan was? He didn't even hesitate. He said, we got to go back and build the walls. We got to go back and build the gates. We got to go back. And the temple's been built, but there's nothing surrounding it. There's nothing protecting it. He says, I got to go. And if I'm going to go, I have nowhere to live when I get there, right? So he says, hey, king, you have all these forests. And I know the guy who runs the forest, and you know him too. How about you write me a letter, king, and tell him that we need all of this stuff. I mean, could you imagine the nerve? I mean, what do you need? Most of us would be like, well, I mean, whatever you can spare. I mean, if you got any, you know, wood laying around, that'd be cool. Man, he's like, no. I need you guys to get chopping out there. We got a city to rebuild. Right? He gives him a plan. King says, how long is it going to take? Guess what? He's got an answer. It doesn't say he just gave a time. What does it say? He gave a specific time. Why? Because he's been thinking and he's been planning. He's not just going by the seat of his pants making this happen. No, God has been speaking and he has been praying and he has been thinking and he has been planning. He gives them a timetable. He gives them a plan. He says, these are the materials that I'm going to need. And he is smart enough to know when I get out there, I've got to cross the Euphrates and I got to head west and I'm going to go through other territories and they're not going to like me being there. So King, I also need a letter from you saying that I have the ability to go do this. And basically, you know what he was asking for? Make me governor over Jerusalem and Judah. He gets the armed escort Ezra said no to. And he goes through. And I love when he gets done talking to the king. And he simply says at the end of verse 8, and the king granted them to me. Why? Because he asked, and he had the courage, and he had the faith, and look what he says. He realizes at the end of the day, this has nothing to do with him. The good hand of the Lord was upon me. Never touch God's glory. Never think it's because of you. I love Nehemiah. And as I close this morning, and we're going to get into this more in the weeks to come, we've talked about what it is required to get into God's will and to do God's will, but I also want to set you up for what doing God's will result in. It's what we see right at the end of this. You know what's going to happen? When you do God's will, now number one, know that you will be victorious, but it will not come without what? Opposition. You say, well, that just seems to be my life. No, that is just the way it is spiritually. It's not because of you. It's because of the garden. If you remember, he said way back then, the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent, they will be at what? Enmity with one another. They will always be warring. When God moves to do something, you think Satan's going to just sit there and let it go unchecked? Now, the question is Satan going to be victorious? Absolutely not. He's a defeated enemy. He just doesn't know it yet. But many of us seem to have forgotten that too. And the truth for us is, you need to understand, and we're going to talk about it much more in the coming weeks. Don't think doing God's will make everything perfect in your life. Don't think that conflict will go away. Don't think that opposition will go away. Don't think for a second that God's will is an easy road. There's always going to be Sanballat, which is the governor of Samaria. There's always going to be Tobiah. To the north, to the east, you got another guy that's going to get mentioned in chapter 5 named Geshem. Geshem is the Arabs. He leads the Arabs to the south. These guys are threatened in their position. They're threatened in their finances. They know that if Jerusalem comes back, I mean, what that means, the trade routes are going to change. They understand what they stand to lose if God keeps his promise and rebuilds Jerusalem. They're going to stand in the way. And folks, you have to be ready for opposition. And you have to determine in your heart that you won't quit because it gets hard. And if there's one thing I've learned in ministry, there has yet to be a decision that I have ever made that every single person in the church goes, that was a good decision, Aaron. You always got the one in the back going, I don't know if I'm going to vote Jesus should come back. I don't know if do we want him back right now? You're always going to have it. It don't matter what you're voting on. We can vote Jesus come quickly and somebody's going to vote no, nay. Apparently that's just the plague of Baptist life. It can't keep us from doing what we're supposed to be doing. So be prepared, church. As Kevin comes this morning, what a challenge for all of us to ask the question, how are we doing waiting? How are we doing with our faith? Do we have the courage that it takes to do God's will? Are we always dependent on God, even in the midst of all that is happening? Do we realize that without Him, nothing is accomplished, but with Him, there is nothing that's impossible? In church, do we this morning, as God burdens your heart, are you just ignoring the burden? Or are you sitting down and praying and saying, God, I don't know if I'm the answer to this, but if I am the answer, let me tell you, I want to be ready when you call me, so show me. Show me what needs to happen. And if you say, get in the game, Lord, I'm willing, I'm ready. Father, we just thank you. Lord, I pray for these people. I pray for myself this morning, that you would give us a passion to know you, to do your will, to be about your kingdom work. Father, we don't want to be slack in the things that you've called us to. So Lord, bring us back to that moment. There are some, Lord, that you might be calling today to salvation. Give them the courage to step out and to say, I need salvation. I need forgiveness. I need Jesus, who is the very reason why this city needed to be rebuilt, because a king was coming and his name is Jesus, and he would save people from their sins, Lord. All of this points to that. All of this is because of that. It's not just about a wall, it's about a Savior. It's about glory, God's glory. Lord, that you would forgive us is an amazing truth. There are some here today, they need to walk in your forgiveness, and Lord, they need to trust today that you died for them. Lord Jesus, you paid the price for their sins. And Lord, you're calling their name today and you're asking them to turn away from the sin and self they've been living in and to follow you and to let you be king. God, give them the courage today to pray and to receive the forgiveness that you're offering right there. They don't need to receive you. Lord, the truth is you have received them if they will just, by faith, cry out. Father, I just pray for this church. And number one, we would hear your voice beyond that initial call of salvation. And Lord, that we would realize that you are calling the name of every believer in this room. You have a task, a purpose. Lord, it doesn't matter if their name is not known. Lord, you grabbed Nehemiah out of obscurity and you placed him. Lord, you'll do it again. You are doing it. If we'll just listen, if we'll just let your burden become our burden, Lord, it'll drive us to our knees, and Lord, you will open our eyes. So, Father, I pray that this message challenges hearts this morning. Lord, I pray that as we go into this invitation, that again, we would just sit as the band sings, and Lord, we would take the time to pray. This isn't a time to stand and sing. This is a time to respond to you. So, Father, keep your people seated. Let them bow a knee to you where they are. Let them come to these altars, whatever your desire is for them. But Lord, I pray that they would not leave this place until they have closed their eyes and they have spoken and responded to that which you've said to them today. Father, we love you. If there is someone that needs to come join this church while others are sitting, may they come. May they say, I want to be part of this family. If someone needs to profess they've come to Christ this week, today, in this moment, Lord, give them the courage to stand right now and to come up front to where I am and just share that with this church. Lord, move in us today in Jesus' name. Amen.